We're continuing our study in the Revelation from a preterist perspective rather than the usual that you may hear on radio and television from the television evangelists. So we're going to begin today with an introduction to chapters 2 and 3, and we'll talk about the first few churches in the Revelation. Now, I'm combining the last two messages I gave at our home church. So this will be on the list as studies number 6 and 7. Just as an introduction to these chapters, let's be aware that Revelation chapter 2 and 3 contains letters, of course, to the seven churches that are listed for us in Revelation 1, verse 11. Now, Revelation 1, 11 tells us that these churches are in Asia. And we need to be careful that we understand what the first century Asia was all about. Where was Asia in the first century? Well, Asia was not a continent or was not considered a continent in the Roman Empire in that day. Asia was simply a province of the Roman Empire. And we need to be aware of that later on when we begin to continue to talk about Asia later on in the Revelation. Asia doesn't change its definition. It is still a province that covers roughly the area today of the nation of Turkey. And in the Roman Empire of the first century, that was the area called Asia. And we need to be careful to interpret it that way because Scripture cannot mean today what it never meant. We need to be concerned about original intent. Original intent if we are to understand Scripture correctly and avoid the condemnation of Revelation chapter 22, 18, and 19, which tells us we should not add to the Word of God and we should not take away from it, and we should hear that warning very carefully and heed it. Now, why are these seven churches in view? Why don't we have more churches than this being addressed by our Lord? You see, in Asia, if the Lord is just talking to Asia, there are other churches in Asia at this time. There's the Church of Troas, there's Colossae, there's Hierapolis. Why then just these seven churches? Why are they selected by Christ? Well, let's think of some possible reasons. First, in looking at the map of these seven churches, it seems they existed on a natural sort of postal route. This was a circular letter, a letter sent to multiple churches with the purpose that it would be read at each one before being sent on to the next church. And so this was a natural postal route, it seems. A possible second reason is the Revelation is committed to the number 7. The number here may be limited to 7 simply because Revelation is committed to the number 7 as that perfect number, that complete number. Certainly these 7 churches were all that Christ needed for his message to the church as a whole. And the apocalyptic genre of the Revelation is less concerned with the details than with the big picture. In coming to the Revelation, as I've said before, we will miss the meanings if we get caught up with trying to explain the details and we miss the forest for the trees. The Revelation is concerned with the big picture, not so much with the details. That's part of the flavor, shall we say, of the apocalyptic genre. But let's consider this symbolic of use of the number 7, which appears throughout the Revelation. It's woven throughout the book. There, the number 7 itself, if you just took your concordance, appears 31 times. There are 7 churches, 7 spirits, 7 stars, 7 lampstands, 7 angels or messengers, 7 torches, seals, horns, eyes, trumpets, thunder, 7,000 people, 7 heads, crowns, plagues, bowls, and kings, and these are used numerous times in different places of the Revelation. The book can also easily be divided into 7 sections. There are 7 blessings recorded in the Revelation. In the Revelation, 7 is a symbolic number. Now, in the Jewish mind, seven is the number of completion or perfection. For example, the creation was finished and God rested in 7 days. And we understand that the numbers, and we need to understand that the numbers in the Revelation are not intended to be actual. They have symbolic meaning. The churches addressed are seven in number, suggesting that while these messages are to individual churches, Jesus is also speaking to the church as a whole. It's true that churches of all time have had similar problems. Some are problems they needed to repent of, and others are problems that are not of their own making, but such as suffering and persecution. But the Christians, we discover in these letters, in each of these churches are capable of being overcomers or conquerors. And God gives promises to those who repent, if they need to, those who are overcomers or conquerors. And in many of these promises, most of these promises are related to the description of the new city, the new Jerusalem in Revelation chapter 20. These are unique letters in all of Scripture because they are uniquely dictated by Christ. Now, these letters are dictated directly from the mouth of Christ to these churches. This makes these letters, again, unique in all of God's Word because Jesus does not directly dictate any other Scriptures to the church. Now, certainly, don't get me wrong, all Scripture is God-breathed. It's the very Word of God, 2 Peter 1:21. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. But other Scriptures are filtered through human authors. We read 2 Peter 1:21 that all Scripture, yes, is God-breathed, but it was through the personality, is through the language, etc., of that particular author. Only these letters, these seven letters, are directly dictated by Christ, and that makes them very unique. Now, the section that we're dealing with right now is sections we're dealing with chapters 1 through 3. And as I said, each section of these seven sections of the Revelation begin with a vision. And we looked at that vision, the vision of the exalted Christ in chapter 1. Now, Jesus, in that vision, walks among the seven lampstands with seven stars in his hands. And as we saw, the seven lampstands are the seven churches, and the seven stars are the seven angels or messengers of those churches. These churches are to be light bearers, just as the stars are light bearers in the heavens, and a lampstand is a light bearer on earth. So the church is to be the light of the world. It's vital the lamps don't go out, the light of the gospel. And Jesus is depicted in this chapter 1 vision, the inaugurating vision of this section, as a high priest tending to the lamps in the true heavenly temple. Some of these lights are about to go out, we will read in these letters. Now, some overall observations. As you may recall, that good Bible-believing Christians have disagreed down through church history concerning how to interpret the Revelation. And one of those views is the historicist view. The historicist view is the traditional, we might say, Protestant view, which existed from about the 16th century through the 19th century. And the historicist believed that these letters gave a synopsis of all church history from the beginning to the end, that each church represented an era of church history. Now, modern televangelists, though they are futurists, they believe that Revelation chapter 4 to the end of the book deals with the distant future from the perspective of when the book was written, but they have adopted for chapters 2 and 3, the historicist scenario. They teach, likewise, and you may have heard it if you've listened to the modern televangelists on prophecy matters, that these seven churches represent eras or ages of the church. And while it is an interesting scenario, and while it makes a good story, there's no evidence that anywhere in Scripture that we should interpret these churches as seven eras of the church. But let's be familiar with what they say, and let me give you the ages that are normally represented by the futurists who take a historicist stance on this section of Scripture. Now, they would say that the Ephesian church represents the apostolic age from the writing of the book to about 100 A.D. They would suggest that the Smyrna church represents the persecuted church from about 100 A.D. to about 313 A.D. at the conversion of Emperor Constantine, when official Roman persecution of the church ended. Now, the Pergamos Age, they would say, is right after that, 313 to about 600 A.D. They would call that the Compromise Church, ending with the rise of the first pope as leader of the Roman Church. And most historians would go along with Pope Gregory being the first pope, though that would be denied by the Roman Catholic Church. The Thyatiran Church Age would be the next age, 600 to about 1500 A.D., the middle of the 16th century. This would be the Roman Catholic Church Age from the first pope, Gregory, in 600 A.D. to the beginning of the Reformation and the beginning of the Protestant movement. So this would be the Roman Catholic Church Age. The next, they say, would be the Sardis Church Age, the Reformation Church Age, and though the Reformation wouldn't care much for how it's described, they would say that, like the Sardis Church, the church had signs of life, but it really wasn't alive, and they would say that went from the beginning of the Reformation in the mid-16th century to about 1700. The Philadelphian Church, according to the futurists, and the Laodicean churches would supposedly overlap. The Philadelphian church from 1700 to the present being the missionary church, and the lukewarm church being the Laodicean church, they would suggest certainly we are lukewarm today. Now, as I said, this is an interesting scenario for these letters, but there's absolutely nothing in the Revelation to indicate this. We need to be careful that even good-sounding stories don't deceive us. There's no evidence to believe this scenario. Again, we need to be cautious that we heed the warning of Revelation 22, 18, and 19 that we don't take away or add to the words of this prophecy, indeed, all of God's word. Now, a major problem with this view is that it suggests the whole church worldwide is or was a certain way at a certain period of time, and I don't think we can prove that claim. Also note that this scheme was created by Western theologians, and it focuses attention on the Roman Catholic Church and its relationship to Protestantism, because this was the Protestant theory, and it forgets the Eastern Church, which never had a papal system. So it would suggest that if this were true, God's only concerned with the Western Church, but he's not concerned with the Eastern Church, and I don't think that's true. Consider that all seven churches addressed here in chapters 2 and 3 existed at the same time in church history within 180 miles of Patmos, within that short distance of each other. And it seems most likely that all seven of these characteristics could be found in some churches of all ages, even in small areas of radius. So these letters are relevant for all of the church of all time, which is the implication of the number seven. Eugene Peterson writes, a random selection of seven churches in any century, including our own, would turn up something very much like these seven churches to which St. John was pastor. Now let's consider some features of these letters. These letters have, shall we say, a general pattern. It's not a perfect pattern, and there are exceptions among the letters, but the general pattern seems to be as follows. David Chilton points out that this pattern has the same general pattern as ancient covenants that kings made with their subject. First, we find these words, to the angel of the church of, and then Jesus, this angel means messenger, as we said. It could be the leader in the church. It could be the reader of the church. It could be the elder. It could be leadership in general. But this, to the angel of the church of, isn't addressed to. This letter is addressed to. And then we have, secondly, the letter is addressed from. These things say, and then Jesus identifies himself in different ways, fitting to the message that he brings to the particular church in view. And in many of the letters, this introduction of Jesus comes from the vision of chapter 1, though not so much in the later letters. Thirdly, Jesus then recounts the works of the church. He says, I know your works. And sometimes that's encouraging, sometimes that's ominous. Jesus knows what the church is doing, and he may have good news and bad news. And so he may have commendations, fourthly, criticisms, fifthly. But only three of the church have both commendations and criticisms. Two churches are given only commendations. That's wonderful. Smyrna and Philadelphia. And only two churches are given only criticisms, and that is Sardis and Laodicea. And I find myself asking about our church as I read these letters from Christ to the churches. Certainly his words are meant to be heard by churches of every age. And I wonder what Christ would say to us. I wonder what, if any, words of commendation he would give. And I wonder, have we been faithful according to his view of the church rather than our own limited and often clouded views? I wonder what things he would convict us of. I wonder where we've missed it according to his view of the church and his investment in her. And leaders, if Christ is indeed speaking directly to the human leadership, and particularly the pastors of these churches, we need to be careful to listen to what he's saying to us. We need to be prayerfully asking how we can better serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Sixthly, there's a call to repentance. This call is, of course, presented to the five churches that receive criticism. And then there are closing features in each of these letters. We read this statement, he who has an ear to hear, let him hear. And then followed by the statement, to he who overcomes. Now, the order of those two features are reversed in the last four letters. I don't think there's any real meaning to that. Commentators really give a good reason why that's so. And again, that's maybe getting caught up into too much detail. Now, let's read the first letter in this section, the letter to the church at Ephesus, Revelation 2, 1-7. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil and your patience, endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know that you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary, but I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. Yet this you have, you hate the works of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, I will grant to eat of the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Now, Ephesus in Asia was an important city. It was the largest city of the area with a population of about a quarter of a million in John's day, it was an important city, just as New York is an important city in America today. And people thought of Ephesus first when they thought of the province of Asia, just as many from other countries think first of New York City when they think of America. Christ-wise, it's a very important city. The church at Ephesus was founded by Paul on his second missionary journey. He didn't stay long, but he left behind a familiar couple that we read about in the book of Acts. He left behind Priscilla and Aquila. Now, another great leader came to the church at one point. Apollos came eventually to Ephesus and was updated in his theology by Priscilla and Aquila. Paul came back later and ministered there for about 3 years, we're told. And while Paul was there, we read that all of Asia heard the gospel. These seven churches and the others mentioned, not mentioned in this section of scripture, Colossae, Hierapolis, Troas, were all most likely founded by Paul. Later, Timothy, Paul's protege, was a church leader here, and then later, John himself, John the Apostle. This is most likely John's home church when he wrote this letter. Ephesus was a very privileged church to have this sort of leadership, given the stature of these great leaders that ministered here. In Revelation 2:1, Jesus introduces himself as the one who holds the seven stars and walks among the seven lampstands, taken, of course, from the vision of chapter 1. And in verse 7, the closing promise to the overcomer is that they would have access to the tree of life, which comes which we read about later on in the Revelation, Revelation 22, chapter 2, verse 2, verse 14, and verse 19. So here in the Ephesus church, we have from the beginning to the end, shall we say, of the Revelation. In Revelation 2 to 4 and 6, Jesus has both commendations, has commendations for this church. And in verse 5, Jesus has a criticism. And he calls them to repent, or the judgment will be removal of their lampstand. It means Jesus will no longer walk among them. Their light will go out. That's a serious warning. The commendations of this church, let's take a look at them. In Revelation 2:2, the church was intolerant of evil. They weren't simply indifferent to it. They didn't tolerate evil in the church. The church is meant, hear this, church. The church is meant to be different than the world. It is to represent the kingdom. It is the kingdom. And maybe we should first focus our attention on evil in the church before we attack evil in the world. We're often accused of hypocrisy when we don't. This church, the Ephesus church of Revelation 2:2, is also commended because it was a discerning church. Discerning of false and true apostles. And later in Paul's ministry, as he traveled to Jerusalem, as he had his sights set on going to Jerusalem and would eventually end up in Rome, Paul calls the leaders of Asia and he calls for the leaders of the Ephesus church to meet him because he has some final words for them. We don't know if Paul ever contacts them again, but here in Acts chapter 20, verse 29 to 31, here are the important words that Paul had for the Ephesian church. Acts 20, 29 to 31. Paul says, I know that after my departure, fierce wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. If from among your own selves will arise men speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them, therefore be alert. Remembering that for 3 years I did not cease night or day to admonish everyone with tears. An early church father named Ignatius in 115 AD, in a letter to the Ephesian church, commends them for being intolerant of false teaching. The record of the revelation and the letter from Ignatius in 115 AD indicates that this church listened to the warning of Paul in Acts chapter 20. This was a very uncompromising church, but this tendency, if we're not careful to be uncompromising, can also make us less charitable. We can lose our first love, and maybe this church had become unloving. Maybe they hated the sinner as well as hating the sin. We must always be careful to hate the sin and love the sinner and be willing to restore them if they repent. Paul also tells the Galatian church in Galatians 6:1, "Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourselves, lest you too be tempted." Also, this church was a persevering church. In verse 3, Jesus commends them for not growing weary. They didn't give up. This church also hated the deeds of the Nicolaitans, verse 6, which Jesus says he hates likewise. Notice that Jesus says he hates their deeds, not the people. The Nicolaitans are also mentioned for us in verse 15 in the letter to the church at Pergamos. In verse 15, Jesus says he hates the doctrines of the Nicolaitans. Jesus commends the Ephesians for keeping this false behavior out of the church, but Jesus criticizes the church at Pergamos for tolerating this doctrine, allowing it into the church. And remember, deeds follow doctrine. Doctrine is important because we act out what we believe. We should be concerned about that today. There's a lot of false teaching out there that denigrates the idea that we should have doctrine. A doctrine is simply teaching. We certainly should be people who are taught. And we should be concerned that our doctrine is biblical, it is correct, and that we follow through on it. And so the idea that doctrine is bad, that in itself is a bad doctrine, a bad teaching. And we should be certainly careful of those that teach false doctrine. Now, who were these Nicolaitans? What were their deeds? Well, a standard answer given by many Bible prophecy teachers to this question of who these Nicolaitans were is they take apart the name Nicolaitan and they say Nikos means to conquest and Laos means people. So Nicolaitans, they say, means the conquest of the people. And some Bible teachers believe that this name refers to those that divided the church at some point in history up into clergy and laity. But in reality, there's really no evidence for that view. A more plausible answer to the question, who are the Nicolaitans, is given to us by many of the early church fathers, those writers of the early centuries of the church. They claimed that the Nicolaitans were followers of a man named Nicholas, who was one of the seven deacons mentioned in the book of Acts. If you recall, in Acts chapter 6, the church elected or chose seven men full of the Holy Spirit to take care of waiting on tables, shall we say, that who would make sure that the responsibility of feeding all the widows, both the Hebrew-speaking and the Greek-speaking widows, because the Greek-speaking widows were being left out. And so there were seven deacons chosen. You know some of them, and some of them are more obscure to us. Nicholas was one of the more obscure ones. But let's read that, Acts 6:5. "And what they said pleased the whole gathering, and they chose Stephen," we are familiar with Stephen, "a man full of faith and the Holy Spirit, and Philip," we have heard of Philip, "and Procurus," we don't know too much about Procurus, "and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas." And then there's Nicholas, a proselyte of Antioch. Now, the early church fathers from the second century said that Nicholas was drawn away into a Gnostic sect, not agnostic, but Gnostic. Gnostic means knowledge, and there was a heretical, shall we say, cult group that believed in things that have been described as Gnostic. They believed, and they said that Nicholas was drawn away into one of these cult beliefs. And he drew other believers after this false teaching. And one characteristic of the Gnostics was their belief that they could sin freely without fear of the wrath of God. The Gnostics believed that anything physical, the physical body included, objects, anything physical, was intrinsically evil, and that only by being done away with the physical, the only way to be holy was to do away with the physical, and so no one would be holy until after death when they put off the physical. The problem, of course, with that teaching is that, okay, if we can't be holy, why even try? There's no requirement, they would say, because it's impossible to be holy while you exist in the unholy vessel. So don't even try. And, you know, in my mind, this is similar to the once saved, always saved theology that suggests that once a person is saved, they can freely sin and they will not lose their salvation. It's antinomianism is another word for it, license to sin. Now, I realize that many who teach a once saved, only saved theology suggest that, oh, if a person returns to a life of sin, it proves they were never saved, or a person continues in sin, it proves they're never saved. The only trouble when push come to shove with that theology, many of these resort to, well, let me give you an example, they would say, we would say, what about this person if he was saved and committed murder? Well, it's possibly still saved. So the once saved, always saved theology does degenerate into this antinomianism, this licentious nature. And so in my mind, it's similar to that. But Jesus says he hates the deeds of the Nicolaitans, that, and I think that the best explanation here for the Nicolaitans' deeds was their continuing in fellowship with the church while living lives of wanton sin. And many of the church fathers give the same explanation for these Nicolaitans, and so I think it's a good possibility. Jesus says he hates the deeds, and he commends the Ephesian church for hating these deeds as well. Now, Christ also says in verse 5, I will come to you. If you don't repent, I'm going to come to you. Remember, therefore, where you have fallen, repent, and do the works you did at first. If not, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place unless you repent. If not, I will come to you. Revelation 2, 12, 16, 3, 3, 311, 320, Jesus says to many of these churches, I will come to you. And these comings cannot be in the future because the Ephesian church and most, if not all other churches, in this, I understand, six of these seven no longer exist. These comings have already happened. They can't be future because these churches don't exist. These lampstands have already been removed by Christ. Now, I don't think there's any Bible teacher that believes that these references to the second, these are references, Jesus says, I am coming, refer to the second coming of Christ. But I think these are an example where we need to understand that not every coming of Christ mentioned in the New Testament refers to a second coming. If that is true here, maybe it's true also in elsewhere in the New Testament when Christ says he's coming. And having said that, I want to note that I do believe in the second coming of Christ in judgment. The church has believed that truth from the beginning. The Bible clearly teaches it, but I believe many of the scriptures used by many Bible teachers today to support a premillennial, in particular, second coming of Christ, are not referring to that event at all. Instead, they refer to Christ's coming in judgment on Judea and Jerusalem in the Jewish War of 66 to 70 AD. That ended with the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple. When we're at an appropriate place in our study, we may take a side trip to look at some of these scriptures. We need to always look at the context. What does it mean when Christ says, I'm coming? It may be in the context that we find in the New Testament where Jesus is going on a short journey or sends his apostles out on a small, short journey, and he's just going to meet back with them. I'm coming to meet you soon. Or it may refer to the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD, and it may refer to the second coming, but we need to look at the context. Also, there are promises given to the overcomers in this Revelation chapter, this letter to the Ephesians. And the promise given in verse 7 to the overcomers, to the conquerors, access to the tree of life. And of course, the same tree of life is mentioned for us in Genesis chapter 3, verse 22 and 24. Adam and Eve were expelled from the garden in order to deny them access to the tree of life, deny them access to eternal life. Now, in the Revelation, the overcomer is promised access to that very tree, and whether it's literal or not, I don't know. I tend to think it's not, because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. He is eternal life. He's always the best reward. But I do know that this message at the end of the Bible is that God is restoring that which was lost when man fell into sin. The way to eternal life is open in Christ to everyone who overcomes and is faithful even unto death itself. Revelation 12:11 tells us, and they have conquered or overcome him, Satan, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives unto death. Now, whether or not we're called to be martyrs or not, we should not love our lives even unto death. If the Ephesian church refuses to repent, the one introduced as the one who walks among the golden lampstands will remove their lampstand. His introduction goes along with the warning he gives if they refuse to repent. Let's look at also at the church at Smyrna. Revelation 2, 8 through 11. Revelation 2, 8 through 11. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last who died and came to life, I know your tribulation, your poverty, but you are rich. And the slander of those that say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested. And for 10 days, you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who conquers, overcomes, that one will not be hurt by the second death. Now, notice that overcomers will not be hurt by the second death. Now, Jesus introduces Jesus' introduction in verse 8. He says that I am the first and the last who died and came to life. His introduction refers back to the vision of Christ in chapter 1, Revelation 1, 17 and 18, where he's introduced with those words. Now, notice in verse 10, this church is encouraged to be faithful unto death. In verse 11, the one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. And so then the one who died and came to life, the resurrected Christ, encourages this persecuted church to be faithful unto death and gives them the promise that the second death, the final judgment, will not hurt them. The first death is certainly death of the physical body, which soon they will experience according to this letter. But the second death is being cast into the lake of fire. Look at Revelation 20, 14 and 15. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death that's mentioned for us here in this letter to Smyrna. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. So then, once again, Jesus' introduction and the closing of his statement to these churches, this church is connected. The one who loses his life for Jesus will find eternal life. Verse 10, I will give you the crown of life. Jesus identifies himself as the one who can credibly keep his promise because he himself died and was risen. Jesus, we're also introduced in verse 9 to Jews who are not, but are described as a synagogue of Satan. Now, again, be reminded, those who persecute the church are of Satan, no matter the name they hold. As I've noted, the persecution of the church in the first century was mainly done by the Jews. There was periodic and localized persecution by the Romans, but the widespread persecution of the church was by the Jews, and if the Romans were involved, usually they were enticed by the Jewish leadership. In John chapter 8, Jesus addresses those who call themselves Jews and likewise calls them children of the devil, just as here in verse 9 of Revelation chapter 2, Jesus addresses himself to these ones who call themselves Jews, who sought to kill him, and he calls them children of the devil rather than children of Abraham. In John 8:44, and you should read the whole chapter sometime, Jesus says to these Jews, "You are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there's no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies." Now, a central teaching of Jesus, expanded on by the letters of Paul, is that God's people have always been people of faith. God's people have never been simply the ethnic Jew. God's people are those who do the deeds of Abraham, who have the faith of Abraham, who love the appearing of the Son of God. The mistake of the ethnic Jew of the first century was believing that they were the people of God simply because they were the physical offspring of Abraham, and that has never been the case, and the record is set straight in the New Testament. This by Paul and by the words of Jesus. The same could be said of Christians. The clear teaching of the New Testament, especially John's epistle, the first epistle of John, is that doing and being like Christ is evidence of real relationship. No one who hates his brother, according to John, has God's life in him. Growing in Christ-likeness progressively is an evidence of true relationship with Jesus. And again, there's another field trip we need to take in the future. But these Jews that were persecuting the Smyrna church are described as the synagogue of Satan. They think they're worshiping God, but they're actually serving the devil. Smyrna in the first century had the largest Jewish population in the Asian province. And later on in the second century, Polycarp, the bishop of the Church of Smyrna, is famous for his martyrdom. This terrible event has been preserved for us by the church, and Polycarp was tied to a stake, we read, and wood was piled around him to burn him to death, but the fire wouldn't burn him. He just stood there singing, is the report, and he was a very old man. And since he would not burn, a soldier stabbed him, and some of his blood extinguished the flames. And while the Romans, it does record, did this burning, and of course Polycarp did die, the record from the early church says that the Jews of the town gathered the wood, and certainly they encouraged the burning by the Romans. Notice that the early church, the only other church to receive no criticism by Christ is the church at Philadelphia. The Jews are also recorded as persecutors of the Church of Philadelphia in verse 9 of chapter 3. "Behold, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan, who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie, behold, I will make them come and bow before your feet, and they will learn that I have loved you." Now, this church, this Smyrna church, is also told this: "You will suffer prison and death, but do not fear. You will have eternal life." Revelation 2:10. The devil's going to bring suffering, but in reality, this is God's test. There's no promise anywhere given here that they will be taken out of this trouble. They will be thrown into prison for a short time, symbolically a period of 10 days. There's a warning that death will be the result and encouragement for the church to remain faithful even unto death. These are believers who receive no criticism from the Lord. They're going through trouble, not of their own making. They're going through prison, and death is coming to them. Now we need to hear that, folks. We need to hear that because these are Christians that love Jesus, that Christ has nothing to say bad about, and yet they are going to suffer prison, death, and death. Trouble, suffering, and prison, and death. Now, American Christians, we have created an entire theology of how we're going to get out of trouble. A very new theology, by the way. A very new theology in church history, and a very erroneous one by the example of the Bible. There is nothing in the Bible that suggests that being a Christian gets you out of trouble. It may get you into trouble. There may be more trouble. We are promised that. It's not for the faint of heart. And it is not to make us rich, healthy, happy, and all of the things that often are associated with being a Christian. Faithfulness to Christ, there's a promise of persecution. And we need to hear this individually, Christian, because you may go through trouble, trials, persecution, sickness. Whatever comes in your life has come to you through the fingers of God. Unless it's the result of your own wrong deeds. Peter warns us not to suffer by doing the wrong thing. That there's nothing blessed in that. But there is a blessing to those who suffer persecution, who do the right thing. And you may be going through some trouble, trials, whatever, and you look at your life and you find, I'm right with God. Everything's right with God and me. This is not the result of trouble. This is not a result of something I've done. My friend, rejoice, because God's got you in his hands, and you will have eternal life. In fact, this promise is the crown of life. Now, this crown of life is echoed for us in the letter of James. Here's an interesting suggestion. James may have read the Revelation, because James says that there is a promise of crown of life. Well, where do we receive any promise of the crown of life except here in Revelation 2:10? And James says there is a crown of life promised. Maybe he is referring to Revelation 2:10. Let's look at those two verses. James 1:12. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial. When he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life, which God has promised to those that love him. Well, there's no other promise given to us anywhere in Scripture except Revelation 2:10. Read that. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison, that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you, here's the promise, the crown of life. Those do seem to go together. James's promises a crown of life to anyone who remains steadfast, and the only place that that is promised is Revelation 2:10. Could he have read the Revelation? Could it be have been written much earlier than we suggested? I also want to take a look at the church at Pergamos. And let's hold off on that until next week, the church at Pergamos. This is Pastor Pete. Stay tuned. We are going to work our way through the book of the Revelation, and it may be a long study. But as we do, it will take us through the entire Bible. It's Pastor Pete. God bless.